My research group uses the tools of modern applied mathematics to investigate problems in fluid mechanics, colloid science, the rheology of complex materials, electrokinetics, and electrochemistry. The primary challenge of the work that we do is to take the observations, say, in an experiment and be able to develop a mathematical model to explain those observations and also be able to predict further interesting experiments to perform. That process really has two steps. The first is taking the results from an experiment and being able to develop a mathematical model to explain those. That often involves knowing what the right questions to ask are. And the second process is then being able to solve that mathematical model. Typically, you can't do that easily, not with, say, a piece of paper and a pencil, so you have to, say, write a computer program to be able to do that, or learn how to develop skills that enable you to tease out what the most important parts of your model are and then solve reduced versions of it. And so that part is actually really more of an art than a science, and it's really the primary joy of the work that we do. I'd like to walk you through a couple of examples from my research group. So the first one has to do with so-called electrophoretic mobility reversal. So electrophoresis refers to the motion of charged micron-scale objects like biomolecules or colloids under an electric field. So you would think if you had a particle which was, say, negatively charged, if you applied an electric field, it would drift towards a positive electrode. In concentrated electrolytes, the opposite happens. Actually, a negatively charged particle will drift to a negative electrode, which is sort of an apparent violation of the fundamental law of electrostatics, or Coulomb's law, that like charges attract. So in my group, we've actually developed a hydrodynamic or a fluid mechanical theory to be able to explain such so-called mobility reversals. The impact of that is the ability to rationally predict the motion of colloidal particles then in concentrated electrolyte solutions, such as brines or ionic liquids, which will hopefully enable separation schemes that will be able to affect particulate separations in such media. So a second area of research that I'd like to tell you about is our work concerning the locomotion or the swimming of organisms. So over the past few decades, there's been a lot of work done in understanding how small creatures swim. So by small, I mean animals like E. coli, which are bacteria. They're typically around a micron in size. And there's also been a lot of work done on how large animals swim, so things like fish. It turns out that if you're very small, viscous forces dominate the way you swim. Inertia doesn't matter because you're not very big. Whereas if you're very large, it turns out that it's inertia that matters. Viscous forces don't matter. So here we're actually interested in trying to bridge that transition between viscous to inertial locomotion. The reason that's important is that there's a number of animals that actually live in that transitional region where both viscous and inertial forces matter. And they actually make up a large fraction of the mass of biomass in the ocean. So our work will be relevant, for example, to understanding how organisms of that scale can affect mixing of their fluidic environments, and also giving insights into bio-inspired propulsion strategies. One of the joys of being at CMU really is that we have a wonderful student population, both the graduate students I work with, who I'm very proud of, and also we have a fantastic undergraduate students. I've been very lucky in the few years that I've been here to work with some amazing undergraduate students, and those students have gone on to top PhD programs and also coveted positions in industry. So that's something I'm extremely proud about.